Good morning, everyone. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Microsoft Azure Cloud webinar. We will be starting in next 5 minutes. Hello, just testing whether the voice is audible.
Yes.
Yeah, it's audible.
You're audible.
Okay, thank you. We'll start in another 5 minutes, as Priyanka said.
Yeah. Thank you.
Hello.
Hello. Yes, you are audible.
Yeah, thank you.
Very good morning to everybody. Welcome to this webinar on Microsoft Azure, which is the public cloud platform from Microsoft. Cloud today is a very important part of technology and technology solutions. And all industries, all organizations are evaluating it very strongly or have either adopted it, are in advanced stages of adoption, or a few of the enterprises are in early stages of adoption. But everybody, all enterprises, organizations would have tried out cloud by now and would have experimented with cloud by now. And it is very critical and important as professionals in the IT world to get on to these new technologies, understand what is the importance of cloud, and understand how we can make ourselves capable of starting to build solutions on this technology. So this session is more about introducing you to Microsoft Azure, the public cloud platform, and understand the benefits, strengths that Microsoft Azure Cloud has over the other cloud providers, and what are the kind of services, solutions that are available on Azure that you can use. And at the end, I will also help you understand how you can build your skills and get certified or become a certified professional for building solutions on Azure. So let me introduce myself first. My name is Ashwini Shahane. I am the president of learning services at an organization called Synergetics. Synergetics IT Services is a 25-plus-year-old organization. We have been partnering with Microsoft for more than 20 years to enable their customers, their partners on all the new technology areas that they release. I'm also a cloud architect and I'm a Microsoft certified trainer. I have also given various certifications on Azure. Agenda for today's session. So we are definitely going to look at a brief overview of cloud technology. Though I'm not going to spend too much time on this, I'm sure everybody's heard of what is cloud. But if somebody is completely new, it'll just ensure that we get everybody on the same page. So we'll look at what is cloud computing all about? What are the benefits of going to the cloud? What are the different deployment types or models available on cloud? What are the different service models that are available on the cloud? And then we'll get on to very specific Azure cloud from Microsoft. We'll look at how Azure scores over the other cloud providers. And then we will look at the different services. Of course, we will not be able to spend a lot of time on each service, but the idea is to give you an entire overview of the platform and help you understand the vastness and the different types of solutions that you can create using this platform. And then, of course, like I said, I will also walk you through what are some of the certification areas in Azure provided by Microsoft, which will help you build your skills and prove your capabilities on that platform. So starting with what is cloud, right? As we all know, cloud is basically a way of delivering services over the internet. Different resources, whether it is compute power in terms of servers, storage, databases, networking support, providing software, providing analytics, intelligence solutions. All these services today are available over the internet and are possible today because of the cloud. Cloud provides us the agility to quickly respond to changes in business and are able to meet the compute storage requirements that come up because of the business needs. So you can very quickly innovate, adapt to the changes because of the cloud. You have flexibility, I would like to call it elasticity of scale. So you provision resources and use them only till you need them, right? So that is a very important characteristic of a cloud. And of course, the scale at which the providers are providing the cloud, it brings us the advantages of the economies of scale. So specifically, if you have to term something as a cloud, it typically would have all of these characteristics, right? A cloud will provide on-demand self-service resources. Now, what do I mean by this? We don't need to, raise a ticket to some IT team for them to create a virtual machine for us or to provide some storage space for us. We can go and provision those resources ourselves. We will be given a portal through which we can provision. So it is self-service, it is on demand. Whenever you need it, you can go and provision the resources. It's a pool of shared resources, and the economies of scale that the provider is able to transfer that advantage to the consumer is because of pooling and sharing of resources. So whether it's compute resources, storage, networking, right? It's a shared pool which is used by different tenants of that service. Of course, the whole aspect of cloud is globally available anywhere in the world, right? So you should be able to access your solutions from any part of the world, and that global access is one big advantage of the cloud. Then, of course, like I said, rapid elasticity. So not only having the capability of provisioning resources when you need them, but also deprovisioning it when you don't need them. And typical workloads, which are driven by demand would require dynamic increasing of resources when the load or the requests increase, and may require similarly dynamic release of resources when the load is no longer there. And the advantage of this kind of elasticity is that you pay only for the resources that you are using, only for the time that you use them. So let's say if there's an application, a web, maybe an e-commerce site, which has a web front-end application. You may want to scale the web front-end application during, festivals and holidays when you are anticipating higher demand for your application. So you may want to increase the number of servers that are providing the application, which are servicing the requests that are coming in. So maybe you would normally have 4 servers, you want to increase it to 8 servers. And when the festival time is over, you may want to reduce it back to 4. And you pay for those 4 extra servers only during the time that you use them. So rapid elasticity and of course pay per use are typical characteristics of any cloud, right? And you would term something as a cloud only if it supports these characteristics. So what are the benefits that cloud computing brings in? And I've already spoken about some of these, but I'll repeat them. One is, of course, cost. Because of pay-per-use, you only pay for the resources. There is no upfront investment in any kind of capital expenses. So you don't need to invest in servers or physical infrastructure. You just provision the resources, provision virtual compute whenever you need it, and deprovision it when the need is no longer there, and pay only for the time that you utilize it. So we are moving more from a CapEx model to an OpEx model. So that brings in a lot of cost benefits itself. Two, speed, agility, with which we can respond to requirements, right? Because we can provision resources within minutes, they are at the tip of our fingers. We can very easily go and provision as quickly and deprovision when required. So the speed, agility with which we can, today businesses can respond to changes in the market is amazing because of cloud. Then of course, global scale. So you can go and deploy your solutions, actually develop your solutions, test your solutions, deploy your solutions from anywhere in the world. So if your customers are located in a particular region, you have the choice of deploying your solutions in that region so that the latency for those customers is minimized. Productivity, right? Again, increase of productivity because of the kind of solutions that are available. You can have more data stored. You can actually go and analyze and get intelligence from that data. So the kind of improvement in productivity is very high. Performance, today you can go and provision high performance compute on the cloud, and the cost or investment is not very high because you're not really investing in the physical infrastructure yourself. So performance wise today we can go and actually think of provisioning really high configuration virtual machines on the cloud with 128 and 56 GB of RAM with about 32 CPUs, and these kind of high processing machines can easily be provisioned and procured today on the cloud. So performance definitely is much better. Reliability. So one advantage of cloud is the kind of redundancy in the resources that it brings about. So there are certain SLAs, availability SLAs, that cloud providers themselves give you when you are provisioning resources on their cloud. So for example, in case of compute virtual machines, Azure provides you an SLA of 99.9% or 99.95%. And they are able to provide you that SLA of availability because of the kind of redundant infrastructure that they have built. Right. So reliability of your solutions, ensuring that your solutions are available at all times is much easier when you're implementing it on the cloud rather than when you're implementing it in your own data center. And not just much easier, also much cheaper. And then, of course, security. And one of the major, I would say, hurdles or apprehensions that enterprises have had over the years for moving to the cloud has been security. So how secure is your data? Will your data be compromised, right? How can you ensure not just data level security, but even security for your application? So cloud, today cloud providers adhere to a lot of public certifications, a lot of compliance certifications that they implement. And as we go ahead, we'll see how Azure provides this kind of security and compliance for our solutions when we are deploying them on their cloud. So these are some of the benefits that cloud itself brings in. So economies of scale, like I said, the whole idea of economies of scale is the ability of providing resources in lesser cost more efficiently. And this is possible for cloud providers and most of the public cloud providers like Microsoft, Google, Amazon, because they can build on the scale that they have and provide these benefits of scale to their consumers. And cloud is always a consumption-based model. So users only pay for the resources that they use. And that is one of the greatest advantages that cloud brings in. So what are the different types of cloud models today? Okay. We know of something called as public cloud, which is provided by your major OEM vendors like Microsoft, Amazon, Google, IBM, right? They own the cloud services, or they are actually owning the physical infrastructure on which the different resources are created, right? So they provide the infrastructure on top of which the resources can be created by us. And of course, we access these resources over the internet. It is open to anybody to go and create the resources on public cloud. Private cloud, on the other hand, is operated or is created for an organization for use within that organization. So when an organization has their own data center and when they have implemented all the characteristics of a cloud, and we saw what are the different characteristics of a cloud, right? Pay per use, which is a chargeback model, self-provisioning, elasticity, whether it is providing scale, right? So all these characteristics of cloud, when they are implemented within your own data center, then they become, then that could be called a cloud, and a private cloud because it's accessible only within the organization. So today there are a lot of frameworks, tools provided, or suites of products provided for creating or implementing your own private cloud. So Microsoft provides us with a suite of products called System Center, using which we can go and create our own private cloud on our own data centers. VMware provides us with the VMware cloud, using which we can create our own private cloud. So vCenter is a solution from VMware for providing your own private cloud. Similarly, we have hybrid cloud. Hybrid cloud is where an organization uses best of both worlds. So they use public cloud as well as private cloud to effectively deploy their solutions wherever they are more appropriate, right? So if there are any restrictions on compliance, on data security, they can actually go and deploy it on their private cloud. Similarly, some of the solutions can be deployed on hybrid. What becomes important in such a solution is that integration between the two clouds and the tools that are provided for managing the different resources created on the two clouds is very critical. And as we go ahead, we'll see that Microsoft's one of the strengths that Microsoft has is that it provides a great hybrid solution. So if you quickly compare the cloud models, public cloud, well, we don't have any capex investments. We don't have to purchase any infrastructure. We can go and provision the resources on the infrastructure provided by the cloud vendor. We get the agility. We can very quickly deploy applications and make them available and also go and release the resources when not required. It's a completely usage-based or consumption-based model. You only pay for what you use. Private cloud, organization has full control over the cloud. Of course, this will mean that you need to invest in your own data center and infrastructure, but you get complete control with the same characteristics of a cloud, right? And because it's within the perimeters of your organization, it is highly secure. Hybrid cloud gives you the flexibility of both public and private. It's a very flexible scenario. You can run the applications wherever appropriate, depending on what is the requirement of scale, security, compliance for that application. Now, when we understand what is cloud, there are different types of services that are provided on the cloud also. So let's understand what are the different service models on the cloud. So the most basic service model is what is called as infrastructure as a service. Right? So infrastructure as a service is where you get the raw compute, storage, networking capabilities provided by the vendor. You don't really need to invest in your own physical infrastructure. They will have the infrastructure, storage, networking all provided and the virtualization platform provided to you. You just need to provision what virtual machines you need and then manage those virtual machines. But you get full control over the virtual machines that you create. So infrastructure as a service gives you a lot of control, a lot of power, but the complete responsibility of management is also on your team. Platform as a service is where not only is the core infrastructure services of compute, storage, networking provided by the cloud vendor, but the cloud vendor also provides the platform for building and deploying your applications, your software, right? So you don't even have to manage the virtual machine and the platform on which your application is going to get deployed. You just manage your application. So responsibility of your application, updates to your application, changes to your application is yours. But the platform and the underlying infrastructure is completely managed by the vendor. And this really brings in a lot of ease and flexibility and agility to an organization for building and deploying solutions very, very quickly. Software as a service is the third cloud service model, where not only is the infrastructure and the platform provided by the vendor, but even the application is managed and hosted by the vendor. So even the updates to the application, the management of the data, the backup of your application and data, ensuring the application is available at all times. All this is managed by the service provider. You just need to use the service. Right? So it is centrally hosted managed software. Right? Users just connect and use the services that are provided over the internet. So one of the most used applications, which is a SaaS solution, are your emailing solution. So whether it is your mailing solution from Google or whether it is your mailing solution from Microsoft. So Microsoft provides you with Exchange Online, where you don't really need to manage the Exchange servers or manage the infrastructure or the applications. You're just connecting and using the service to read and write your emails. So if you look at comparison, well, IaaS, which is infrastructure as a service, gives you a lot of flexibility, a lot of control, but it also gives you the responsibility of managing the platform on which your application is going to run. PaaS brings in or increases the productivity because you get a managed platform from the service provider. You can focus on the application and the requirements of your application and the actual business problem that you're trying to solve without getting too tied up in the infrastructure piece of it. You also today have serverless computing, which is something which works on top of PaaS, where the cloud provider also handles the scalability for your solution, and you don't even need to worry about that. So where, on which server is getting hosted, how it is getting hosted, how many servers is getting hosted, you really don't need to bother about that. So serverless computing is one step more ahead of PaaS. And then of course, like we said, SaaS is a complete subscription-based model where you just use the services. You don't bother about even managing the platform or the application. So if you look at it from a management perspective, this is how it would look. In infrastructure as a service, the lower layers of the physical infrastructure and the virtualization is managed by the vendor, the provider, while you manage the platform and the applications that are running on top of the platform. In platform as a service, even the platform is managed for you by the vendor, and you just manage the application that is going to run on top of that platform. Right? So whether the not only the physical infrastructure and the virtualization platform, but also the platform that is going to run on your virtual machine, the middleware software, whether it's web servers, database servers, all that, the runtime environments, the libraries, the frameworks that your application requires, all this is going to be managed by the provider. And in software as a service, everything is going to be managed by the provider. You just use the service. Now, when it comes to Microsoft, Microsoft actually provides multiple cloud solutions. They have something known as the productivity cloud. They have something called as the business cloud. And then, of course, they have their cloud platform. So when it comes to productivity cloud, right, the entire Microsoft 365, or what we call as Office 365 solution, is part of the productivity cloud. It is a SaaS-based solution, providing all the productivity tools, solutions required for organizations to help their workforce become more productive. So whether it is emailing, whether it is communication, whether it is collaboration, all the specific tools that are required for this are part of your productivity cloud, which is Office 365. So you'll see the solutions like you have Skype, you have Exchange Online, you have SharePoint Online, you have Office, you have Teams, right? So various, there are about today 25 plus solutions in that suite called Office 365. Then of course they have the business cloud. So Microsoft has also been providing products for business solutions, that is ERP, CRM systems. So what they are now doing is they're providing those as services in the cloud, and that is what they call as the Dynamics 365 cloud, which is again a SaaS solution. Now for, so both the Office 365, Dynamics 365 are SaaS solutions, but for organizations who want to host their own native applications on the cloud, who want to develop applications for the cloud themselves, bespoke applications, they have, Microsoft is providing the cloud platform, which provides infrastructure services, platform services, and software services called Microsoft Azure. So I looked at the typical overview of what is cloud computing, and I hope I convinced everybody that it is really beneficial to move to the cloud. Let's quickly have a look at what is it that Azure brings in. So let's look at the core architectural components of an Azure cloud. So Azure is made up of multiple data centers, and these data centers are globally located all over the world, and these are organized into what are called as regions. So one particular region is an area, a geographical area, which can have one or more data centers, typically more than one data centers that are close together, networked together with low latency access. So you have different Azure regions. So for example, we have regions like Southeast Asia, we have regions like East Asia. So there are various regions that are available. There are some special regions also. So for example, government cloud is a different region. China is in a different region because you cannot, unless you have a business in China and you have a identity in China, you cannot actually go and buy Azure subscriptions on the China cloud, right? So you need to be part, or you need to have a presence in China to be able to use the China cloud, and it's not open to everybody. Similarly is Germany cloud, right? So there are certain clouds which are special regions. Then most of the regions also have a paired region, right? So the whole idea of a paired region is that they are within the same geography, and it allows you to, you know, have redundancy of your resources across regions to kind of take care of disasters, right? So like I said, Southeast Asia is one region, East Asia is another region. So typically Southeast Asia and East Asia are paired regions, right? Different markets or different geographies have different compliance boundaries or have different data requirements, right? Security requirements. So typically what Microsoft has done is that they've also clubbed multiple regions together into one geography. Yeah, so they have right now categorized as the Americas, Europe, Asia Pacific, Middle East, and Africa as the different geographies that are there. Of course, every geography may have multiple regions. Every region may have multiple data centers. There are some regions, and this is not available currently for all. As newer regions have developed, for most of the newer regions, we have availability zones, right? So availability zone is typically where you have multiple facilities within one location, right? That means we are talking about multiple data centers, multiple buildings equipped with their own independent power, cooling, networking, capability. So this acts like a, you know, isolation boundary in itself. So if one region has multiple availability zones, when redundancy is required for resources, the redundancy can be applied even at a availability zone stage, where even if one availability zone goes down in that region, then at least your solutions or your applications are available on the other availability zone. But within a particular data center, right, within a particular availability zone or region, how does Microsoft ensure that your applications are not affected by any physical failures, hardware failures, or by any kind of maintenance activities that Microsoft may need to do on the server, is the physical infrastructure that they will be providing the resources on top of. So Microsoft has the concept of what are called as availability sets. So in a data center where you have racks of blade servers, physical servers, each rack has its own, you know, cooling, networking, and power supply. So that is one point of failure within Azure. So if a rack goes down, what happens to your applications or virtual machines that were running on that rack, right? Similarly, you have, like I said, Microsoft may go and apply maintenance, apply patches to the host servers which are hosting your applications. So how does it ensure that, you know, it does not affect the availability of your application? So Microsoft has this concept of fault domains, which are basically the physical racks that are part of the data center. And they have an update domain, which is more a logical collection of, you know, servers which are going to be updated at the same time. And when you are provisioning resources, when you're provisioning compute, right, if you specify an availability set and you specify those resources within an availability set, Azure ensures that these resources are created on different fault domains and different update domains to ensure that at least one of them is always available to you. And then, of course, we have the concept of a resource group. So a resource group is a logical collection of resource. You can think of it like a container, but it's a logical container. It's a way of managing multiple resources as one unit. So the entire lifetime of the resources can be managed together through a resource group. Right? Any resource you create in Azure has to be part of a resource group and can belong to only one resource group. Resource group can also act as the security boundary. So when you want to give access to users to your resources, you can give access at the resource group level. So you can have role-based access provided at a resource group level. So that is another powerful use of resource groups. And today, the deployment model used in Azure is what is known as the Azure Resource Manager model, where you have resource providers for different types of resources. So we have a resource provider for compute. We have a resource provider for storage. We have a resource provider for networking. Depending on what type of resource you're trying to create, Azure will invoke the appropriate resource manager to go and provision that resource. Now, every resource you create, like I said, has to be in a resource group, and all resource groups have to be part of what is called as a subscription. So a subscription is like the, I would say, boundary, billing boundary within Azure. So you are billed per subscription. So before we go on to what are the different services on Azure, let's quickly look at what would your management portal look like when you're working with Azure. So let me share my screen. So like I said, when you want to work with Azure, you need to first of all procure an Azure subscription. Now there are various ways in which you can get a subscription. You can either go and purchase a pay-as-you-go subscription, in which case you just go to the Azure site, and so you go to azure.microsoft.com and go and buy a subscription using your credit card. This is more like a postpaid, you know, subscription. So you use the resources first, and end of the month, your credit card is charged for the resources. Enterprises can actually get Azure subscriptions either as part of the enterprise agreements, licensing agreements that they have with Microsoft, or it could be through a cloud solutions provider, a reseller, what we call as a CSP, through whom they can buy Azure subscription. Okay? So you need an Azure subscription before you can actually start creating resources on Azure. So for those who are new to Azure and if you want to try or work with Azure, you can go to azure.microsoft.com. And you can go and create a free account. Right, so you can actually go and create a free account and get started with 12 months of free services. Right, so what do you get? You get certain services free throughout the year. Of course, there's a limit on what or which services you can use. You initially, when you create the account, you get about a credit of about $200 that you can use within a month. And in this 1 month, the first month, you can actually use any service you want. Any service you want, right? But within that credit limit of $200. For 12 months, you can use a lot of the free services that are available. So there are some of the new services are actually being provided by Microsoft. There are free tiers that are also there. So you can use those all the time. And there are a few services which are again available free. So you can use this trial account to actually try working with the Azure services. Right, so this is also one way for at the time of learning that you can go and create. Now, when you create an account, you associate, or when you create a subscription, you associate it with a Microsoft account, which is an Outlook, Hotmail, or a Live account. And using that account, you log into the portal, right? The management portal of Azure is portal.azure.com. And when you log in, right, you will get this dashboard. Now, your account could be associated with multiple subscriptions. So every Azure subscription, the membership of that subscription can be managed through an associated Active Directory. So Azure also has a service called Azure Active Directory. So every Azure subscription has an associated Azure Active Directory through which you can do your access management, right? So your IAM can be done through your Azure Active Directory, which is associated with your subscription. And then you can go and create resources. Like I said, there are various types of resources that are available. So if you see all services, you'll see the entire set of services in different categories. Right, so you'll see the number of categories that are there, and each category there will be multiple services that are there. So whether it's compute, whether it is networking, storage, web, containers, databases, you'll see there are a huge set of services that are available. If you go to create a resource, you also get a marketplace from where you can get any resource that you want. So Azure Marketplace not only has resources provided by Microsoft, but they also have resources provided by Microsoft partners, right? So you may have virtual machine images, you may have application services, SaaS solutions, which are all part of the Azure Marketplace from where you can go and buy it.
Right. So example, if I go to databases, you'll see I have solutions for MariaDB from Microsoft, but I also have solutions by partners for CouchDB and so on. Right, so various solutions that are available. So I'm going to go and create a resource. But before I go and create a resource, I'm going to also go and create a resource group. So let's go to create a resource. And I'm going to create a resource group. So I can very easily search for what type of resource I want. And like I said, resource group is the entity which is the boundary for all the resources that you want to create. So for different solutions, I can create multiple resource groups. So I'm just going to change my subscription. I have access to multiple subscriptions. And I can select which data center I want to create this on. So I'm going to create it on Southeast Asia. You'll see India also has 3 data centers of Azure. So we have South India, West India, and Central India. So there are 3 data centers that are available in India. So I'm selecting Southeast Asia, and I'm creating this. And then I can go to the resource group. And then within the resource group, I can go and create the resources that I want. So I can go and add a resource. And I'm going to add a virtual machine. So I'm going to select Windows Server. And it'll ask me which version of Windows Server I want. So I'm going to select Windows Server 2016 with 2016 data center and create it. I can select the resource group I've just created. So I'm going to add this server into this resource group. I can give the server a name. Right, I'm going to select the data center in which I'm going to create it. So I'm going to select Southeast Asia. I'll change the size of the virtual machine. So there are multiple different sizes that are available for virtual machines. So right now it has chosen this size, which is DSV2, which is 1 core, 3.5 GB. RAM, I'm going to select a 2-core 7GB machine. But you'll see that there are various sizes that are available, and these are just some of the types of a family of servers that are there. There are multiple different types. So I have high performance compute, compute optimized, memory optimized, and so on. I need to give the Windows username password for this machine. And I'm also going to open certain inbound ports. So I'm going to allow RDP access because I would want to configure that server. And then I can go and add what type of disk I want. So I can have a standard disk or a SSD based disk. Okay. And then I can specify which virtual network is equal to add it in. And by default right now, I'm selecting the default options. So it's also going to create a public IP and network interface for me. I can set up diagnostic tools. I can set up auto shutdown for the machine. Right, and I'll go and create it. So it's pretty simple using the portal to go and create resources. So this was just an example of how you would work and create resources. So it has passed the validation and I'll start creating. So while this is happening, let's continue with the presentation. You can, if you have any questions, you can put it up on the message chat and I will look at it at the end. So let's quickly look at the core services and products that we have. Right, so when we talk about core services, we are talking about compute, storage, networking, right? So I'm going to look at these core services and see what are the kind of options we have on Azure. So compute is, of course, for running applications, for hosting applications. So it provides the computing resources such as processors, memories, disk, operating systems, and so on. You can provision within minutes, like you just saw, I provisioned the virtual machine and within a few minutes it will get created. It's pay per use. In fact, you are charged per second of usage. So if I use the machine for, let's say, just 2 minutes and 40 seconds, I'll actually be charged only for that much time, right? And it's the common on-demand compute services from Azure are virtual machines and containers. So let's have a look at these two. So when we talk about virtual machines, I'm sure everybody who's aware of virtualization as a concept is aware of what is a virtual machine. So when we talk about infrastructure as a service compute, Microsoft provides us with, Azure provides us with a service called virtual machine, where we can create virtual machine with whatever platform we want. And we are responsible for managing that machine. Azure gives us an SLA for the availability for that virtual machine itself, ensuring that the machine itself is available. Secondly, virtual machine is a stateful machine. That means whatever changes we make to the virtual machines are getting persisted. Okay. Now, what do we have as part of virtual machine services? Well, one, under infrastructure as a service, we have Azure VMs and Azure VM scale sets. Azure Virtual Machine, we've already looked at. Azure Virtual Machine scale set is where we can have auto-scaled Azure VMs. So VMs which are going to host the same kind of workload and you want to scale that workload, you can have auto-scale enabled through Azure VM scale sets. App services and functions are PaaS solutions, but they, of course, internally would use virtual machines on Azure for hosting the applications that we are deploying. Now, because it's PaaS, if you remember our PaaS definition, not only the infrastructure, but even the platform on the virtual machine is managed by Microsoft. And what is very important today is Microsoft provides not just Windows, but even Linux as a PaaS platform. So they manage the Linux platform for us. And it's highly scalable, very easy to deploy it supports multiple deployment models like FTP, web deploy, Git deploy. There are many deployment models that are supported. Highly scalable, easily manageable applications, and you can deploy different types of applications to web app services. You can deploy web apps, you can deploy mobile application, that is mobile backends. You can apply, you can deploy API apps. So various types of applications that it can deploy. Azure Functions is the serverless solution, compute solution on Azure, where you simply write a piece of code and give it to Azure for hosting. Now you may decide to manage the hosting and control the hosting by hosting it in within an app service. Now, app service provides either a shared model for compute or a dedicated model for compute. So depending on what you've selected, your functions will run on those virtual machines. But functions also supports serverless compute. So as and when that function is triggered, Microsoft will ensure that the function gets deployed and executed on some virtual machine and made available to you. So it actually creates the infrastructure on based on a trigger or an event. Then under compute services, like we have virtual machines, we also have container services. Now containers is a new deployment concept which is becoming very popular today. Unlike virtual machines, containers do not have the operating system, so they are very, very lightweight. They are designed to be created and highly scalable. You can create and stop containers very, very quickly. So most of the applications today are getting designed and deployed using containers. Azure also has support for containers. Not only does it support the popular Docker-based containers, which are typically Linux-based, but they also support Microsoft Windows containers also. And Microsoft has PaaS solutions for containers, where you have Azure container instances, where you can go and create just one container instance. And this is more for, you know, kind of testing and development time, right? You just want to check whether your application is running properly within the container and so on. But for a production environment, you have Azure Kubernetes service, which is providing you a scaled container with manageability, orchestration through Kubernetes. And all this as a PaaS service. Then you have broad set of Azure networking services. So if you must have seen right now, when I was creating a virtual machine, I had to specify the virtual network in which I had to create the virtual machine. So like we create networks on premise, we have subnets and we define boundaries for our network. We can similarly set up a virtual network on Azure. Azure virtual network supports things like firewalls, it supports things like, you know, network security groups, it supports public as well as private IP addresses. It supports network interfaces. It supports load balancers, both public facing as well as internal facing load balancers. For hybrid integration, you also have VPN gateway to set up secured IP secured tunneling between sites.
We are having some questions.
Sure.
Yeah. Ashirvad is asking how security is provided on public cloud. Can someone access his VM from public cloud?
So I think just hold on to your question a bit. I will be answering it when I look at security. So I will be discussing security. But to quickly answer it, yes, it is your choice whether you want to expose the virtual machine on the public internet, right? There are basic at the cloud infrastructure level that Microsoft has certain security measures that it implements. But at the application level, maybe at the user access level, the customer will also have to implement certain security level. But yes, it is your choice, like I said, if you want to expose it on the internet or not.
Okay.
The other options, if you want to expose, do not want to expose it, is then you need to set up some kind of site-to-site secured connectivity integration between Azure network and your on-premise network, so that you can securely, using the private IP, access the virtual machine.
Ma'am, one more question is there from Anita. She is asking how to enable network on VM to connect remotely.
So, Anita, depending on what kind of VM you are creating, so if you are creating a Windows VM, you need to have RDP enabled. By default, RDP is enabled on a Windows image that you select from the marketplace. If it is a Linux-based VM, then you need to have SSH to be able to connect. And again, you can connect either using certificates or using username password. So when you're creating the VM, you can configure it accordingly.
Ma'am, there is one more question from Vaibhav. He is asking, we get all out in cloud, and in case of internet failure, can we work offline?
Unfortunately, Vaibhav, no. Any cloud service that you go to, you will need the net access, and what kind of experience you have with the cloud will also depend on what kind of internet connectivity or bandwidth you have. So, no, unless you build a solution in such a way that you have a hybrid solution, where even if you're disconnected from the cloud, there is something running on premise, which you can continue to use. And whenever their connectivity is established, again, there is some kind of sync that happens. So it depends on what kind of solution you provide. But typically, if you're, you know, deploying to the cloud, or say only to the cloud, then no, you will require internet connectivity. Arya, regarding your question about Azure over AWS, I will try and answer it in a different way. I unfortunately will not have time to do a head-to-head comparison between the two, but I'll try to at least highlight what are the strengths of Microsoft Cloud. So hopefully that will answer your question.
Ma'am, Arya is asking, what are pros, if any, Azure over AWS?
Yes, I just addressed that, Priyanka. Right, so I will not be able to do a head-to-head, but I'll try to bring in the strengths of Azure over the other ones.
Ma'am, one last question is there. Vargis is asking, once created the virtual machine, how he is going to be used that?
Yes, so I will just try and show that in some time. So when it comes to storage services, let me quickly get into storage services. So Azure also has storage services for both structured as well as unstructured storage. The Azure core storage service is what is known as Azure Storage. And most of the other services actually make use of Azure Storage. So whether it is virtual machine, disks are stored in Azure Storage, right? Any kind of files you upload to Azure typically will go into blob storage. Right, which is our unstructured storage. Right now, Azure Storage is a highly scalable, available storage service on Azure. And like I said, there are different kinds of or types of information you can store. It can act as storage for any kind of data, any kind of blob, any kind of disks that your virtual machines or applications would be using. You can map it as a file share, or you could use it as the storage for your packed up data, which you're not going to access very often. For database-based services, today we have SQL database on the cloud as a PaaS solution. I have only put SQL database over here, but actually it also has open source databases today available as a PaaS solution. We have MySQL available as a PaaS solution on Azure. We have PostgreSQL available as a PaaS solution on Azure. Like we have SQL database available as a PaaS solution, and MariaDB available as a PaaS solution. And all of these are managed, provided by Microsoft themselves, right? For NoSQL kind of solutions, non-relational data, right? We have Azure Cosmos DB. Cosmos DB supports all the different NoSQL solutions. So whether it is key value storage, whether it is document based storage, whether it is graph based storage or columnar storage, Azure Cosmos DB supports all of these. And not only that, but it also supports APIs for most of the popular NoSQL solutions. So for example, if I store document based data in Azure Cosmos DB, I can access it using Mongo API, which is one of the most popular document-based NoSQL databases. Or if I store, let's say, columnar data, I can access it using Cassandra API, which is a popular NoSQL columnar-based database, right? Azure also provides a database migration service in the cloud, which provides tools and utilities for migrating data from on-premise to cloud or from one cloud to another cloud seamlessly with minimum downtime, right? So a lot of all these data services are provided. Like I said, Azure Marketplace is the right place where you can go. You have solutions provided by Microsoft themselves, by Microsoft vendors, partners, by ISVs who provide their own products or services. Right, all this is available on my Azure Marketplace. And then we have different management tools for working with Azure subscriptions and solutions. So we have the Azure portal, we have Azure PowerShell, we have the command line interface that is provided. We've seen the Azure portal, right? So similarly, you have different tools. So before we go to solutions, just quickly show you. We have created that virtual machine.
Hello, ma'am. We are having one question from Subhash. He is asking, is there any specific case where we need to use Azure SQL than Azure Cosmos?
Yes, so SQL, Subhash, is for relational data storage, while Cosmos is for NoSQL storage. So depending on what your requirement of your solution is, you will use the appropriate storage. Today, in fact, Azure and the kind, because of the cloud and the kind of storage solutions available on the cloud, a lot of solutions or applications you create may actually land up using multiple storage options. You know, for certain structured data, it will use database storage. For a certain non-structured data, it will use the NoSQL storage. So you have the choice when you're designing your application on which type of solution to use. So our virtual machine is created, so I'll quickly go to the resource. And like I said, we need to have, since I've created a Windows machine, if I want to connect to that machine from outside Azure and take control of that machine, I need to use RDP. Now, if you look at the networking for this machine, you'll see there is a security setting or security rule that has got set up. So when I was creating the machine, I said allow RDP access. So it has created a rule saying the RDP port 3389 allow access, right? If this rule was not there, I would not have been able to connect to my virtual machine from outside Azure. Because of this rule and because I have a public IP associated with my machine, I can access the machine over the internet. So if I go to the overview section and I click on connect, it will give me the RDP connectivity for that machine. So I can simply download the RDP file. I'm opening it. And click on connect. It'll ask me for the user credentials using which I need to connect. Now, if you remember when I was creating the machine, I had provided a username password, which would be the Windows admin user. I'm going to use that to connect to this machine. Right? And as you can see, it will go and connect to that machine and give me access to that machine. And then I can configure it like any other virtual machine. Right, so it is as simple as doing this. Okay. Now, we look at certain core services of compute, storage, and networking, but there are a lot of services on Azure which are, domain specific for a particular application domains. They are specific ready-made solutions available for different types of applications that you can create. So let's have a look at some of these domain services that are provided. So we have services for creating IoT applications, right? And I'm sure today everybody has heard of IoT. So how you can have devices sending huge amounts of data to your backend services on Azure, and how you can create an entire analytics dashboard based on the data that is coming, can be done to the IoT services on Azure. So you have IoT Central, which is a global IoT SaaS solution, which is easy to connect, monitor, and manage the different devices and IoT assets for you. Similarly, you have IoT Hub, which is hosted in the cloud for acting as the listeners for the endpoint where the devices are going to send data. And through IoT Hub, you can actually have two-way communication. So through your backend solution, you can also communicate to your devices. So that can be also done.
Hello, ma'am. We are having one question. In case while we enter the RDP credentials for logging in, we face network issues. How do we roll back the credentials once the network issue is resolved?
Now, I'm not sure I understand your question, but if you're saying that you have some net connectivity issues when you're trying to log in, definitely will not be able to connect itself. So like we have IoT based solutions, services, we also have services related to big data and analytics. Big data is something that has maybe become possible because of the cloud. Big data refers to huge volumes of data with where the data is coming at high velocity, and different types of data is coming and getting stored in your Azure or in your cloud storage. And then you can use this huge volume and different types of data to analyze and gain intelligence out of that data. So we have a lot of solutions on Azure today for being able to analyze big data. One, for structured data, we have the SQL data warehouse, which gives you, massive compute capability by providing parallel processing, right? And you can execute, queries on huge amounts of data, petabytes of data. So the SQL data warehouse is one such solution. Second, you have Azure HD Insights, which is if you have heard of Hadoop, right, which is one of the most popular analytics solutions for big data. HD Insight is Microsoft's Hadoop as a service solution, right? So you can very quickly create a cluster of Hadoop cluster of nodes and have your big data analytics being created on it. It supports multiple frameworks. So you can have Edgebase on HD Insight, you can have Spark on HD Insight, you can have Storm on HD Insight. So multiple frameworks are also supported. Then you have Azure Data Lake Analytics. Azure Data Lake is a storage solution on Azure, which allows you to have a highly scalable storage for multiple types of data. So not only structured relational data, but even non-relational data can be stored in one location. the way analysis is done today is different from how it was done previously. Previously, to analyze data, we used to first extract, transform, and only load that data which is required for analysis into the analytic solution. Today, because of the ease and the storage solution being so much cheaper, we can store a huge amount of data. So today, the analytic solutions have changed where you load the data first, you gather all the data first in one central repository, then you extract and transform the data through analytics. So data lake is a solution which addresses this kind of changed mode of analysis. And then, of course, very popular solution today, which is actually getting a lot of attention, is artificial intelligence, which means creating your own machine learning models, which means creating your own solutions based on the data and creating models that will learn from your data. Azure has great solutions for creating this. So you have the Azure Machine Learning Studio, which is meant for novices who are trying to get into machine learning and AI. You can actually have a drag drop experience of creating an entire ML model without writing a single line of code. But for experienced data scientists, right, if you want to create your own machine learning models, you can do it using Azure Machine Learning Services, which provides you with end-to-end lifecycle management for your data science projects, right from building the models to testing the training the models to testing the models to deploying them as services and operationalizing them, and then managing and tracking and continuously, I should say, improving the model. So you have Azure Machine Learning Services. It's not listed here, but you also have Azure Cognitive Services, which are ready-made SaaS solutions where Microsoft has already trained and created the models, and we can simply use them as services within our application. So whether it is related to video analysis, whether it's related to vision services, whether it's related to speech, whether it's related to audio services, all these cognitive services are today available on Azure. And then, of course, you have various options for serverless computing, right? Functions we've already discussed. You have Azure Logic Apps for creating workflows or processes, creating business processes and exposing those as services very easily. And again, you can host them on a serverless compute environment. Even Grid is a completely managed service for publish subscribe kind of a model, where one of the application components will trigger an event which will cause or which will invoke another component which will actually go and process the event when that event occurs. So you have Azure Event Grid, which can be effectively used for building loosely coupled applications. And then you have DevOps for ensuring or managing the entire lifecycle of your application development, right from code repositories to building tests and testing your code to doing packaging of your code, building your code to deploying your code. So you can also automate this entire pipeline by creating your own continuous integration and continuous deployment solution, CI/CD solutions. You can even automate the entire CI/CD pipelines using the DevOps solutions on Azure. Now, I have listed a few.
Archana is having one question. She is asking, can we customize the solutions as per requirement?
Yes, you can. So it depends on which solution you're talking about, but yes, most of these services will require some amount of customization to meet your application needs.
And ma'am, Anita is asking, we have a Azure VM connected using RDP, and by mistake, if we disable network using local area connection, so RDP connect has lost. How can we enable the network on that system?
No, so the connectivity loss is on your side, right? So once you fix the connectivity again, you'll be able to get the connectivity to Azure machine. You need to have the internet connectivity at your side.
Okay, ma'am, we can host it.
So if you go to Azure or Microsoft.com and you go to products, you'll see the different categories. I have covered only some of the solution areas. So I have covered AI machine learning, I have covered analytics, I have covered compute databases, I've covered DevOps, I've covered IoT, but there are so many others which are there, right? You have blockchain today available on Azure.
Once again, Subhash is asking, do he have rebuild option for this in Azure under VM settings, like reset RDP configuration? Is it will fix the issue?
No, no. See, RDP access depends on whether you have internet connectivity or not. Right, once that is done, and yes, if there are any issues, you can always connect with Azure support and resolve them. You can very easily fix. You have a lot of diagnostics available, right, from boot diagnostics that you can capture and try to resolve the issues that are there. You can always reset passwords also, even that is available. Okay. Right. So like I said, I have covered some of the solution areas. These are, so you can always go to Azure or Microsoft.com and look at the other areas that are there. So let's quickly look at some FAQs, because I knew some people would have these questions. So I have tried to answer some of the questions that are normally asked. One is related to security and compliance. Right. So is Azure secure and compliant? Yes, security and privacy are built into the platform. And let's see how. So first of all, Azure data centers itself have, defense in depth strategy applied. So right from the physical security, that is physical access to the data center, to identity, to perimeter, to network level access, to compute level access, application data, at all the layers, they have security implemented. Microsoft has a great white paper that they have published on how they have actually implemented this defense in depth in their data centers. And it's a very interesting read for anybody. Again, it's available on azure.microsoft.com, and you should go and read that. So you have a choice on how you want to secure and what kind of security solutions you want to implement. So at the perimeter layer, you have your virtual network itself sets a security boundary at an isolation level, but you also have Azure DDoS protection that you can enable and enhance. You also have Azure Firewall that you can enable for your solutions. At the networking layer, you can define what traffic gets access to your virtual machines through network security groups by creating inbound and outbound rules, right? So you can define who can access your machines by defining that. So like I showed you, we have a rule which allows access to 3389. Now currently the rule has been created to allow access to anybody, but we can restrict it by saying allow access only for certain IPs. Right, so you can make it tighter and you can define what kind of security. You can even combine multiple security solutions together, right? Like for example, web application firewall with Azure Firewall, or network security groups with Azure Firewall, and so on. It is a shared responsibility ultimately. So depending on what type of solution you are using, right, it will be a shared responsibility between you as a consumer and Microsoft as the provider. For IaaS, Microsoft is responsible for the physical infrastructure and security, but security of your machine and whatever is running on it, it is your responsibility. For PaaS, the entire platform of the virtual environment is secured by Microsoft, but application network level security, it's a joint responsibility between Microsoft and customers. So Microsoft will provide certain solutions, but at an application level, from an identity perspective, you will have to make your application itself secured. Access to your application will have to be controlled by you. Microsoft can't do anything there, right? In a SaaS solution, even the application level access and all will be controlled by Microsoft. Who has access, the identity, the directory, the users, that is something that you and Microsoft will jointly share. On the compliance front, Microsoft has the largest compliance certificates in the industry, right? So whether it is industry level certificates, whether it is region level certificates, with, you know, you name it, and they have that for their Azure data centers. So whether it's ISO, whether it is PCI DSS, whether it is HIPAA, right? All of these certifications are today available on Azure. In fact, Azure has more certifications, compliance certifications, than any other public cloud vendor. So if your application requires a specific type of compliance or specific type of security, you can always work with your Microsoft teams to ensure that that gets implemented for you. Second question, is Azure only for Windows apps and services? Well, again, no. Azure supports open source technology completely, right? So today, at any level, if you see, whether it's infrastructure, the actual platform, whether it is database or middleware, whether it is application frameworks, whether it is applications or management tools, right, DevOps tools, everywhere today, Microsoft is supporting open source across Azure. In fact, 1/3 of compute running on Azure, or actually more than 1/3 of compute running on Azure today, is Linux. Right? Microsoft themselves is providing Linux as a PaaS solution, where they are managing the Linux platform for us. What more can we ask for? Right? So you'll see all the open source solutions today are possible on Azure Cloud. So it is no longer just about Microsoft products and Microsoft solutions. Will Azure work for my industry?
So ma'am, we are having one question from Vaibhav. If there is a security breach on Azure and my data is compromised, can I claim damages?
So this, Vaibhav, like I said, data application and data access to some extent is a joint responsibility, right? So you also need to ensure, and you have been provided tools and services on Azure to ensure data security. So if your data is very critical, for example, whether it is Azure storage or whether it is Azure database, you have the option of encrypting data even at rest, right? So if your data is so critical, you should actually go and implement some of these security solutions, right? Azure provides them, but it doesn't enforce them. You will need to go and ensure you implement them for your solution, depending on how criticality and how secure you want your solutions to be. Secondly, Microsoft themselves very clearly in the agreement have said that they will not provide data that they are storing on their cloud to any entity, even to the governments, without informing the customer, right? So they will in no way compromise on that. So when it comes to industries, well, if you go to again Microsoft site, you'll see that there are solutions for different industries today, and different industries are adopting cloud very actively today. Some of the industries which are, because of the nature of the business, have, you know, very easily adopted cloud or industries like retail, right? Which are like e-commerce businesses and so on. right? They definitely use retail. They definitely would benefit from the scale performance provided by the cloud. Industries like manufacturing, healthcare, life sciences, the kind of compute that is required sometimes for the kind of research that is in health care industry. Cloud makes it much easier to, you know, have that kind of compute power. Manufacturing, a lot of IoT-based solutions are predominantly getting implemented here with cloud as the backend, right? Even BFSI, government, where there is a lot of compliance and security restrictions are also actively going to the cloud. So there are a lot of banks in India also which have already adopted cloud, a lot of investment insurance companies which have adopted cloud. So you'll see that all the industries today have adopted cloud. So if not now, in your near future, definitely your organization will also look at cloud. Well, how does Azure compare to other clouds? And this was one of the questions, AWS. Well, Azure, I think, has one of the best hybrid story, right? Because Microsoft has a big presence on premise, they already have a lot of products that are being actively used by enterprises on premise. They are invested in providing or implementing hybrid solutions. Right? So Azure has one of the best hybrid story that is there today across all the public cloud vendors. Azure has more regions and is more globally distributed than any other cloud provider. In fact, Azure has more data centers than even Google and Amazon put together. Okay. It provides solutions across spectrum of solution areas, like we've seen, right? Whether it's AI, whether it's IoT, whether it's DevOps, right? The whole focus is in improving the productivity of the enterprise and the enterprise teams. And it provides one of the most comprehensive compliance coverage, which again, we have already looked at. So why is Azure the right choice? Well, productivity, hybrid, intelligent cloud, right? So Microsoft is actually slowly moving towards providing an intelligent cloud. And they do a lot of dog fooding where a lot of their own solutions are used internally first before, you know, making it available to users. So they are even trying to make their cloud intelligent, right? And of course, trusted because of the compliance and security certificates that is there. So they, because Microsoft is targeting the enterprise segment, right? Another difference is AWS is, you know, always targeted the startups and that particular community. While Microsoft, right from the start of Azure, has always targeted enterprise segments because they have a strong enterprise presence, plus they have a strong set of solutions in enterprise environment. Well, having had a look at Azure, I'm sure one of the important questions on your mind is, how do I build skills or capabilities on Azure, right? So Microsoft has a lot of certifications for different roles. Right, so they have identified different roles people can play in the cloud from a cloud solutions perspective, and they have identified skills that those roles will require. So they have identified apps and infra as one area, data and AI as one area, modern workplace, which is mainly related to Office 365 and Microsoft 365 solution, and business apps, which is related to Dynamics 365. So these are the areas that they have identified, and these are the different roles that they have identified. So I will talk only about the Azure certifications, which is apps and infra and data and AI. So we have Azure administrator, we have Azure developer, we have Azure security engineer, which are associate level exams. And then we have Azure solution architect and Azure DevOps engineer, which are expert level certifications. Then at the data and AI side, we have then Azure data engineer, we have a data scientist and we have a AI engineer, right? So these are the certifications that are there. So if you look at the apps and infra certification, this is the way in which the paths would flow. Azure Fundamentals is optional. You don't have to have that certificate. You can directly go in for any of the associate certifications, which is Azure Administrator, Developer, or Security Engineer. To do DevOps Engineer, you would need to pass at least Azure Administrator or Azure Developer. But to do Azure Solutions Architect, you do not have to have any of these. Like I said, every certification, every role has certain skills identified. So what are the skills required for the certification? So for as an Azure Administrator, you should be able to manage subscriptions, resources, work with storage solutions, virtual machines, virtual networks, identity, right? And Microsoft gives a certification, an exam at the end, which will kind of certify your skills. So the exam over here is AZ-103. Now to prepare for this exam, there are many options that are there. One of the options is using either an instructor-led training or a self-paced online training. So they have a course. If you take the instructor-led training, it's a four-day course. Or you can have this course available online, and it is available on Future Skills Portal. So if you just go to the Synergetics provider on Future Skills, you will see this course being provided online. It's a self-paced course, which you can use to prepare for Microsoft Azure Administrator. This course has material, it has labs that you can do to build skills and gain knowledge on the different areas that have been identified before you take a certification. Synergetics also is providing today the exam vouchers for giving the certification exams at discounted rates. So you can always connect with us and, you know, take a exam voucher at discounted rates. So similarly for Azure Developer, the certification is AZ-203. And these are the kind of skills that are measured. And in case of AZ-2003, there are multiple courses that you need to do. So they have modularized the course breakup for different skills that are there. And you can take these courses again in an ILT format where you can have instructor-led training, or you can do a self-paced course. These are also available on Future Skills. For DevOps engineer, like we saw, we have to either do administrator or developer before we come to DevOps. And for DevOps also, there are courses that are available for preparing for the exam. The exam is AZ-400. And then architect, you have two papers that you need to give because this is an expert level exam. You have to give two papers to two exams to get the certification. You have AZ-300 and AZ-301. And there are courses available for both, preparing for both of these. Microsoft has also released Security Engineer course, which is again exam AZ-500. It is more from a point of view of managing security solutions on Azure, securing solutions on Azure. And there is a preparatory material for that. These are some of the new certifications that Microsoft has released for data and AI specifically. So you have Azure Data Engineer, you have Azure Data Scientist, and you have Azure AI Engineer. And there are again various exams for this. For Azure Data Scientist, you have an exam DP100. And you have for Data Engineer, you have two exams, DP200 and DP201. And these are the material. For data scientists, the material is not yet released. It should release in a month's time. And for AI engineer, you have one exam, which is AI 100. And you have a course for doing AI 100 also. So if you are interested in any of these certifications and discounted exam vouchers, you can connect to Shilpa Awad. Shilpa will help you with any queries that you have. Like I said, all these courses are available in self-paced online learning mode on the Future Skills portal. So you can go to Future Skills, look for Synergetics, and these courses are available.
Hello everyone, there is a small announcement. We are sharing one feedback form with all of you all back through the mail. Please share your experience with us.
Like I said, please connect at this email ID if you have any queries related to skilling yourself. We can definitely guide you either through self-paced courses on Future Skills itself, or you can attend an IELTS-based course with us. We also have blended solutions where you can do the online learning at your own pace, and we provide mentoring through a few mentored IELTS sessions with our experts. SMEs. So you can do that. We also provide, like I said, exam vouchers on discounts. Do also follow us. We are on Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, YouTube. So do also follow us for, and you will get the latest updates, information about more sessions that we do. We do a lot of community activities, meetups. We do a lot of virtual sessions, in-person sessions. Please follow us and you will definitely get all the information. We do a lot of sessions, not just on cloud, but on different emerging technology areas and also on AI and analytics. So thank you for being so patient. I'm sorry I extended the time a bit, but there's a lot to cover like you saw. And I definitely hope to see a lot of you all on the journey to cloud. I will share my email ID also in case you want to connect with me with any queries that you may have. I'm sharing it on chat.